see how this, I can barely run my iPhone, so I can see how this works. How you guys doing?
Good.
Hey, Baltimore. Awesome to be here. You guys all local?
No.
I've been to the show in a while. It was really great to come here. I was super thrilled to be invited, and we got to hang out with all the retailers here on Thursday. And had a great signing day with you all along yesterday. And, today's going to be awesome. This is my last day here today. So I do this panel. We started the Turtles 30th anniversary. I actually believe the Turtles are 32 years old. Let me adjust my depends. But it's the Turtles are 32 years old, and as I like to say, first and foremost, it's all your fault. So thank you very much. I wouldn't have the literally the coolest job in the universe without all your support and fans. And I know a lot of you seem to be some of the older fans, some of the original fans, which is mind blowing in the sense that it actually worked the first time around, and now here we are, 32 years later. And it's, seems like it's kind of resonating to a whole new group of younger fans, which is even like more mind-blowing to me. Fantastic, and again, I thank you.
So. I'm not talking loud enough. Okay, can you hear me now?
Well, again, it's a thrill to be here. The first thing I'd like to do is give a shout out to my friend and co-creator, Peter Laird. Without Peter Laird, the Turtles wouldn't be the Turtles. He is my brother, and he's awesome, and you know, we really thank you. Peter Laird is the it. He's awesome. This is the first cover. Again, it's like I always like to show this because it's amazing. You know that it's 32 years old. The first again, you know, the creation of the Turtles. But what it started out with really was a parody of all of our favorite things in comic books. You know, I grew up as a huge fan of Jack Kirby. So did Peter, and we actually bonded almost immediately over Jack Kirby. This is a my tribute to Jack Kirby. I know most of you know who Jack Kirby is. For anybody that doesn't, just he was the guy that with Stan Lee either created, co-created, created most of the entire Marvel universe. And to me, he was a huge inspiration. He's the guy that when I found his comic books when I was younger, like 8, 9 years old, and I told my parents probably that I'm going to be a comic book artist when I grow up. They had this horrified look on their face. They're like, oh my goodness, this, we're going to have one of those kids that never moves out of the basement. and it was all Jack Kirby's fault. And this other, the little pencil page you see on the side here is an unpublished page from The Losers. And the first time I met Pete, I was actually trying to sell some of my work for Sandy Magazine. He had done some work for it in Northampton, Massachusetts. And they sort of moved on to other things. They weren't really published in this comic book magazine, but they said, wow, you should meet this guy, Peter Laird, who does the same weird stuff you do. And so I wrote Peter a letter back in those days when you had to write letters to communicate. And he responded by that. I said, hey, I kind of live locally. I just moved into the area, and I like to, you know, meet some like-minded people. And so he invited me over to the studio, and this Losers page was hanging on his wall in his tiny little studio, and I'd never seen a Jack Kirby original, so I almost passed out. And he later gave it to me. It's probably hanging in my studio today. So it's really fantastic. Awesome to hear. This is actually the house in a very small town in Dover, New Hampshire, where the Turtles were created. I grew up in Maine, East Coast. I spent most of my summers from Memorial Day to Labor Day cooking lobsters and trying to make enough money to survive the long, cold winters. And Peter and his then fiance, they got married in the same house. They had a vacancy in their room, so in their house, they said, why don't you move into a formal studio and we can, you know, work on projects and try to work together. And so I moved into this place, and we came up with the name of Mirage Studios, which is still one of the studios that worked on a lot of Turtle stuff. It was a Mirage Studio. It was a Mirage because this is what our studio. Little tiny, I actually found that chair in a lawn sale, I think it was $3. And we had this tiny little TV that only half the screen came in clearly. And this is where one night, November of 1983, with Pete used to watch what I thought were some of the goofiest shows. He used to love like TJ Hooker and the A-Team and that stuff. So I felt it was my job to annoy him as much as possible while he was watching his favorite shows. And so one night I had this idea. I thought to myself, if Bruce Lee was an animal, what would be the the silliest animal, grizzly would be, I thought of a turtle, and so I did this sketch. This is literally, that's the first turtle ever drawn. Later to be named Michelangelo. And so I put it on Pete's desk and I said, this is gonna be the next big thing, and I called it a Ninja Turtle. And, you know, studio went out and shipped, you know, he of course had to top my drawing, so he did this little sketch, changed a few things. This is so cute. Changed a few things, and of course, again, studio went out and shipped, I top his drawing, so I did this pencil drawing. I figured, one, why not a group of them, like, you know, the X-Men, Avengers, and all the stuff that we read growing up. So I did a pencil sketch of four turtles, each holding different weapons. And it had this kind of comic book-y Ninja Turtle logo on it. So I did it in pencil, and he inked it in. He had a teenage beauty to the title. And so this was November 1983. This was the first drawing of the turtles ever done as a group. And we looked at this thing, and we said, all right, this literally is the goofiest thing we've ever seen in our entire life. So because of that, I would say we didn't have any distracting pain work going on. We said, why don't we come up with a story that tells how these characters came to be, and we will write it and draw it for ourselves. Because, you know, who's going to buy a copy of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? Seriously. So we started working on the origin story, and what we did is we put all of our favorite Jack Kirbyisms, all the favorite Ninja Leather Book comic books. You know, particularly my favorite Jack Kirby comic book was Command and the Last Boy on Earth. And I think that's where the mutant sort of factor came in. And then the parody factor came in from, you guys know Cerebus, Cerebus the Art Bar? Dave Sim was a self-publisher, started very similar. He was a big inspiration to us. And so he said, why don't we self-publish it? We'll write a story for ourselves, because again, nobody's going to buy a copy of these. And so we started, okay, what would the origin be? What would this be? What should we call them? And so I was a huge fan of art history. I always loved art, always loved art history. In high school, this is actually the goal I did. I graduated Westbrook High School in Maine in 1980, and it was my tribute to Leonardo da Vinci. And so we were going through names, and it's like, well, traditional Asian names seems most appropriate, you know, for the characters, but, you know, we're talking Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, it's not really silly enough. Well, Doug, Bob, Steve, not quite silly enough. And so I just wrote it out, I said, what if we call one of them like Leonardo da Vinci here, and Michelangelo? And he laughed, he thought it was funny, so it was Leonardo, Michelangelo, and Raphael came very quickly. Then we had a little debate over the fourth one because Pete liked Donatello, and I like, there's a sculptor named Bernini who was, I thought was a much better sculptor than Donatello. And so Donatello was almost named Bernini. But I think we flipped the coin or something, but Donatello won out. I'm glad I like the Donatello. Suits him very well. So the turtles premiered at a very small convention in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, 1984. It was May 5th, 1984. This is the flyer that was actually done, and look at these two guys. I mean, that was me, 50 pounds ago, trying to grow a mustache, and Peter. And we, you know, the books were printed in April of 1984. We got just in time for the show, and we tried to invite as many friends and family as we could, so it looked like we had a crowd on our table. But that was the first time, that was the premiere of the turtles, and again, you know, 32 years ago. The fact that I'm sitting up here now after all this time is all your fault again, so. Sincerely, very sincerely, thank you. You know, around this time we started to really, you know, we're going to a number of conventions, and, you know, everybody's heard about San Diego Comic-Con. Well, you know, San Diego's got nothing in Baltimore. I think this is a really cool show because, you know, you get to meet the artists here. I think this is a fantastic show. I'll be inviting you back next year. But our first year at San Diego, we got to meet this guy, Jack Kirby. And this was probably like, one of those, I think my mouth was so completely dry, he could squeak, you know, let alone speak. but he was our inspiration. He was the coolest guy on the planet. And I remember San Diego that year, in 1985, they were hoping for like 8,000 to 10,000 people to attend. And it was still so very, very small. And when Jack Kirby came into the building, it's like literally hushed them over the whole place. He'd be like, Kirby's here, Kirby's in the building, Kirby's here. So Pete and I dropped everything and ran over where Jack Kirby was, and he was just finished telling his story to this fan about how he created Captain America. And it was just, you know, every fan there, about 50 people surrounding him, hanging on every word, and the fan next to him asked the same exact question. And he answered it with the same love, the same passion and everything. You just could tell this guy really loved what he did. He loved his creation, he loved being a comic artist, and that just to be reconfirmed that You know, if I am ever so lucky to continue to have a career in Congress, I hope I'm as lucky and as cool as Jack Kirby, because he's a cooler guy. So that was awesome. In the first issue of the Turtles was a single story meant to be, you know, told, and you know, we never thought we'd do another issue of the Turtles. We only didn't think it very finding. For us, becoming Jack Kirby, the dream came true. We solicited for Turtles issue 2 in 1985. We had pre-orders of like 15,000 copies, and I remember Pete called me and said, first nobody's asked us to do a second issue, so we should, but people start asking to do a second issue. They said, you know, if we had 15,000 copies, if we do 6 of these a year, we can make about $2,000 each. We can eat all the macaroni and cheese we want, we can pay our rent, and our comic books for a living. So that was really kind of a dream come true. And Turtles issue 2, we introduced one of the longtime Turtles characters, was April O'Neil, who's still around in all the cartoons and movies today. And as the issues went on, I wanted to introduce another human character, kind of a big brother character. As you know, the Turtles characters, Raphael's kind of a Wolverine, kind of a berserker kind of guy. And I thought it'd be fun to do a story that where, what if Raphael met somebody crazier than him, might make him look inward a little bit. And so Casey Jones was created for that purpose. And he just turned out to be, you know, not only one of my favorite characters, but a fan favorite. And so this was kind of cool. This is one of the covers, one of the pages from the issues from 1985. Casey rules. In the early issues of Turtles, and I signed a bunch of them today, which is so cool, is like all the early Turtle issues 1 through 4 and the Raphael Nutshell was all done oversized, which was kind of a printing accident that we never fixed. And around issue 5, we had gotten a lot of complaints from retailers and stuff saying that we wish you did a comic book the same size that everybody else does so we can put them in comic bags. But we also thought it was cool that we had to start doing color covers. So this is the first color cover. It was Turtle issue 5. It was the first issue that was comic book size. And in Turtles issue 3, we started this storyline where we took the Turtles into outer space, which kind of told a little bit of the backstory of the ooze and where it came from, this alien substance. And we didn't actually really want to take them out of space because we were huge Star Wars fans. Love Star Wars, so the first thing we had to do in one of the issues was put them in a cantina scene. And if you look carefully, you see like a medical robot on the side there, and AT-AA, you see a bunch of characters. We did just enough so that George Lucas wouldn't sue us, but we had to do a Star Wars cantina scene in there. And one of the interesting things is, because all the Turtle books were black and white and all the early covers were just two colors, this is the first time I painted the Turtles with the bandanas all the same color. And, you know, we knew who they were. We always put the weapons, we tell what the weapons, we call each other's names. And so, for the longest time, all the original Mirage comic books had the Turtles with red bandanas, and that changed later when we did the animated stuff, and I'll talk more about that in a bit. This is one of my favorite pages. And that a lot of people don't know. I mean, Turtle Stars are black and white comic book in 84. Pete and I did the first 15, 16 issues together. And after that, we started working on more entertainment stuff. We still work on the comic book series regularly, but this is a page from Turtles issue 11, and it's one of my favorite because that sort of sums up the whole what we loved and what we wanted the Turtles to be, which is this misfit family. So we've got Casey Raphael, the father who was playing Turtles, and this is one of my favorite pages. And back in these days, Pete and I would still literally pass the pages back and forth. Every single page had most of, we shared the chores on equally, both writing and drawing, and that was really fun. Around this time in 1987, we started getting calls from people that thought the Turtles could do much more than a comic book series, and we laughed and laughed a lot because we said, you know, this barely worked as a comic book. You know, it was working as a comic book. You know, I can't imagine this ever being a cartoon show or toys that people would buy. But we liked the idea, and then we were very lucky that, you know, because we only controlled all aspects of our creations, that we could, you know, really dictate what was to be done with the Turtles and what wasn't to be done with the Turtles. So, like, all the early animation, I mean, we worked on 300 cartoon episodes, all the movies and toys. We had full say over everything that was done with the Turtles, and this is where the idea came about with the different color bandanas, because the toy company and the animators were like, well, how can you tell them apart? And like, you know, the weapons, duh. And they said, well, you come up with something that helps tell them to differentiate them a little bit, and Pete actually came up with the idea with the different color bandanas. Michelangelo Orange, kind of a silly character. Leonardo Blue was kind of a regal sort of leader of white character with samurai swords. Raphael, he kept as our original red, our raging berserker kind of guy. And then Donatello is purple, came from his bow staff weapon. It's kind of a monk, typical monk weapon from Asia. And so purple seemed to be sort of this nice color that fit them. So we started doing, working on the animated series. We started working on the toys, and again, you know, not thinking that anybody would watch them. And it finally came out in Christmas of 1987. There was a school break between Christmas 87 and New Year's 1988, and the ratings did well enough, so they went and greenlit another 8 shows. And then in June of 1988, the toys came out. And again, we didn't believe we'd actually be able to see them in the toy store. And back in those days, you know, Toys R KB Toy Store was the pre-Toys R Us store. And so we went down to this place in Springfield where they were actually, we heard they were for sale down there, so we were walking all the way, you know, walking through the toy store down towards the action figure aisle. Just as we got to the action figure aisle, his father was dragging this young boy out of the action figure aisle saying, "No, I'm not buying you one of those stupid Ninja Turtles." And we were like, "Ah, what have we done?" It was crazy. The toys took off, and the cartoon show took off, and again, you know, it's your fault. Fantastic. It was such a great ride. We really had such a good time doing all those. And with the success of the toys and the animated series, they asked us to do a live action movie. And we were like, "Oh my goodness, how do you pull this off?" You imagine that the comic books are drawn, the toys, the cartoons are drawn, and you know, the toys are sort of 3D prototypes based on the cartoon show. You know, how do we pull this off as a live action series? Well, we were very, very fortunate. We're not only able to work with director Steve Barron, but the amazing and incredible and genius Jim Henson is the guy that built the turtle suits, built the turtle costumes, and pulled that off. In fact, most of the technology that was done, I should share some slides on that, most of the technology done to bring the turtles to life, they literally had to create or invent just to do the turtles. But it was such a crazy time. I love this. Like, this is, they actually did, remember that? Pizza! But they literally sculpted the turtles out of clay, full size. They would cast the actor, they would cast the actor's whole body so that the suits were then designed to fit a specific actor so that, you know, the rubber, when they would flex and move their muscles, it would actually look more realistic. And man, those suits weighed about 80 pounds. And, you know, I can barely do martial arts or, you know, basic workout. And imagine the martial artists wearing these things, wearing an 80 pound suit, doing those back flips and those spin kicks and doing all that stuff. Those guys were absolutely amazing. Nice picture. It's awesome. It's a great shot of Jim Henson on the set, and 50 pounds ago, still working on mustache, no tattoos. But yeah, the puppeteer that you see off to the side there is, they had these sensors that sort of let the actor, he would sort of mimic the actors what the turtle needed to say, and would help move the turtle's lips synchronize with these servos and stuff. That's why turtles with the shells, it was perfect because they had these big, huge metal server electronic things in their back that held all the things that made them work. And then he worked the eyes, he just off to the side. With Casey being one of the my favorite characters added to the Turtle series, when they put him into the movie, that to me was just the, you know, the best of all possibilities. Actually, some of the scenes, that's what we were very thrilled to work with Steve Barron, so much of the material that he pulled from the original comic books he actually put on the screen, like in the Raphael one shot, there's this showdown between Casey and Raphael in the park, and they recreated that in the movie. And the Last Potatoes, actually two things. One, not only was The Last Potatoes the best Casey Jones like ever, to me he was like the perfect embodiment of that character, everything that I imagined in my head, that way he brought it to life. But I know over the years we've done a lot of different cartoon series and movies and that kind of stuff, but this first movie was, to me, will always be the ultimate. There's none better, and it's such a high watermark, I don't think. I don't know what you guys think, but that was a great movie. So let's jump forward to, any of you guys watching the Nickelodeon series? Yeah, awesome. If you haven't seen it, check it out. It's very, very good. You know, Cyril Neely is the executive producer of that, and I was friends with Cyril before he got the DVD. Not only was he a genius artist and a genius creator, but he grew up, his father owned a pizza parlor in Philadelphia. So he grew up eating pizza, watching Turtles, and drawing. And he now runs the shows. And what he puts into those shows, he really takes a lot of time and care to put tip of the hat or characters from the original comic series, from the original animated series, and sort of blends it into this whole new platform of funny and some really weird stories that I love. I just love the characterization. I like that Splinter's much taller as a character. The Turtles are, you know, the first episode of the series, the Turtles come off the ground for the first time. And even like the recreation of Casey, I love that they made not only April a much younger version of April, she's more on the same level of the Turtles. They call it like the fifth Turtle. That's why she put that little number 5 on her shirt and then add Casey to the group. Instead, we actually put it on the hockey stick. You put my name, Eastman, and you put Laird on the hockey pad. But if you've seen the series, one of the most popular characters out of the series is Ice Cream Kitty. Have you seen that? If you haven't seen the series, I actually did the voice of Ice Cream Kitty. That's why it's the most important character ever. Ice Cream Kitty was a Casero, and I consulted in the series, and I wrote a couple episodes. I knew when I wrote this coming out for season 5 next year. Casero wanted me to do a voice of one of the characters. He's like, oh, come on, a really cool, a good guy or a bad guy, or have you be this character. And one year in San Diego, they had this series of drawings of new characters they were developing. And this cat character is based on the Michelangelo one shot that he and I originally did. It was a Christmas story where Michelangelo finds a cat and names it Quonk. And so they said, we have this. Michelangelo finds this cat, accidentally exposes it to another ice cream, but has mutagen spilled on it. So it turns to a cat made out of ice cream. And I said, I want to do that character. And they're like, no, we'll find something else. I'm like, no, dude, I want to do that character. I'm serious. That's like perfect. I just want to be able to go to a comic show and have a t-shirt that says, I am Ice Cream Kitty. And make my poor wife, who's sitting there, Courtney, wear a shirt that says, I'm with Ice Cream Kitty. Ice Cream Kitty, I love you. You taste so good. Most of the work I do at Turtles right now, like I said, I consult in the animated series, I consult in the movies. And to a short extent, you guys seen the movie? Actually, I got some slides of that, but there's a pizza delivery guy in that movie that's awesome. Not only for an Oscar. But this, most of the work I do in a series right now is with IDW. I've been working on a series for the last 5 years with the incredible Tom Walls. I always love to say I want to be Tom Walls when I grow up. He's such a genius. He really came up with a whole new story foundation for the IDW comic series. It's really developed, thanks to the support and people that read the series. I don't know if any of you guys are reading it. No, we didn't kill Donatello, but it's been a really fun series, and I get to do graphic novels, I get to co-write a plot, and then work on an ongoing series, and it's one of the best jobs ever. I get to work with some really incredible artists who I love, and I also hate them because they draw Turtles better than me. But if you haven't seen any of the IDW stuff, check it out. It's some really fun stuff. Not only do I get to do, I did a collection of 200 covers that I did, we put a series of these hard covers. I signed a bunch of them for you guys here, and I appreciate you lighting them on, because those things weigh more than a small child. Those hard covers are huge. You guys light them on, which is awesome. Collected number 6 is a really fun book that just came out earlier this year. It collects all the short stories, the original short stories that Peter and I did with a lot of the in-house and launch videos. In some of the covers books that I showed, a lot of stuff you can see is behind the scenes. I like to show the process of our work. You can see it on my website, kevinsonstudios.com, or some of the IDW books. But I basically do a blue pencil like that. Once I get a design, I ink it in, and it's colored by this amazing artist I work with in Hungary. And you can do fun things. That's just some behind the scenes stuff. This is a cover. You guys know who Simon Disley is? You ever meet him in the show? If you do, stay 10 feet away from him. He's awesome. He's crazy. Crazy, crazy guy. And this week, the cover I did, I penciled and signed the game for the 30th anniversary of the Turtles. And one of the other fun things we did for the 30th anniversary was, you guys know who Robert Rodriguez is? He's the director of Sid City, Spy Kids, all that stuff. A lot of people don't know he's a really talented artist. And I was visiting a studio once, and he was showing designs for this animated series he was developing. And I said, wow, this is really great. Who did these drawings? And he said, I did. And so I said, if I pencil the cover, would you make it? And so this is his first comic book cover ever published, so a little bit of fun factoid if you need to know. Earlier this year, we teamed up with a lesser known character to try to see if we could make him popular again. This was the coolest gig ever, and this was the scariest thing I ever worked on in my life. And James Kennedy's downstairs, he's the writer of the series, and when DC and IDW teamed up to do a series, I'm like, always goes as a dream comes true. How are you going to pull this story off? Well, the writer, again, James Tenney, is downstairs signing, and he did. He actually pulled off a wonderful story. We led the Turtle Universe in the Batman Universe, and I thought he told a great story. The response from fans has been really good, so I appreciate it. But again, these were the scariest conversations. You know, back in the early days of comic conventions, I would do sketches of turtles dressed up as like Batman and Captain America and try to sell them so I could buy comic books. We actually do turtles and Batman on the same cover. It was like scary. It was cool. But just dealing with stuff like this, like Turtle and Batman, Shredder and Batman showdown. Actually, I pitched in this idea for a follow-up. I don't know if they'll do it or not, but Turtle and Batman costume. Right, that is the that would be kind of funny. I wrote apologies to Frank Miller on that as well. Besides all the turtle stuff I do at IAW, I'm an exclusive creator of them, and they're letting me do a lot of fun things. I've got a couple of new series coming out. This one came out early this year that I do with my friend Simon Disley. It's called Fistful of Blood. It's basically vampires, zombies, alien bounty hunters, mayhem fun, not for all ages, but tween and up. But it's some fun stuff. If you like goofy mayhem, you're really going to kick out of that. This some of the pages from that series. I think the trade paperback came out about a month ago. The next series I'm working on after IDW is a series called Los Angeles. It's kind of my love poem to Walter Hill's Warriors movie that he did back in the early 80s. I was a big fan of that movie. And so I kind of expanded that concept. It's a love story take place in a post-apocalyptic LA. This is sneak peek at some of the stuff that I've been doing on a series. These are my layouts. All that is going to be finished in color and all kinds of tomfoolery, fun, lots of action. That's also not necessarily for all ages, but let me check it out. Have you guys seen the new movie again? Let's talk about the pizza delivery guy. It was that 4 seconds in the beginning of the movie. That was me. That was my cameo. Actually, the first time I've done a cameo in the movie. I did a cameo in the first movie, but it was like, there's a scene where at the end of the first movie where they set up where the garbage truck comes in and they end up squishing Trevor at the end. They asked me to be like Ernie the garbage man, where I carry these garbage bags out in front of the garbage truck, and I look down the street and I see the turtles and all the foot soldiers fighting, and I panic, drop the garbage bags and run back down the street. And so I'm telling all my friends and family that I get this great cameo in the movie, and I'm expecting this really dramatic close-up shot of me going like, and all that. But if you watch the movie, it's like cameras here, two turtles fighting, Leonardo fighting about 20-foot soldiers, and about a mile down the street, you see this little black blob. Sort of walk out and go back, well, that's me. So it's like telling your friends, you know, you were a stormtrooper in Star Wars. But the new movie was fun. I was like, especially enjoyed the fact that they brought these two guys into the movie. You know, Bebop and Rocksteady have been part of the Turtles universe since the early cartoons. I thought the actress that did it, in fact, you know, oddly enough, Courtney and my son, you know, son Shane, who's 10, is a huge fan of Sheamus. Like, the first WWE wrestling match, we took him through the live match so he could see Sheamus, and he got to meet him in Comic-Con this year. Couldn't say a word. He was like, ugh. He's like, but Sheamus is about 19 feet tall. But seeing Casey Jones in the movie and these two guys, it was really fun. I thought they did a good job. It was a fun movie. So the team up of the movie, if you guys haven't seen the series, it's out there now. It's called Bebop and Mars Didn't Destroy Everything. And maybe you should it's a really fun comic series. One of the cool things, and I signed a lot of them at the show, thanks for buying them. We launched this new series starting this month, The Turtles Universe. And this is my wraparound cover. Every once in a while, I love doing the single covers I do for IDW, whatever. I sort of twist around and then you do a wraparound cover so that I can jam every single character in the Turtle Universe in there, and I try to in this one. This is one of the variant covers that's floating around the show. And as I said, they did the comic hit stores literally this week. One of the cool things is that I get to work with my longtime friend, Bill Sienkiewicz. He draws pretty well. Sorry, I guess. I love Bill. We've known each other for years, and I pitched this idea. I said, why don't we do a little backup story? And it was kind of our, I always wanted to revisit one of my favorite Turtle comics, which is the Leonardo one-shot, which is almost this continuous battle through the whole issue. And so we're getting 20-page stories broken up into 4-part segments, and this is the first 4-parter that's in the new Turtles universe. And I think you guys are going to have fun to see where we take it, because it gets really crazy. A couple other things we're doing, if you ever want to find out what we're doing, how to, KevinShipStudios.com is the website. It's a fan website. We have a fan club you can join. You can follow what I'm doing, where our signings are. You can behind this is behind the scenes stuff. And then we do certain special things like this is a new line of Turtle Toys that's coming out for a company called 3-0. They let me design every aspect of these. I designed all the weapons, the style, the re-envisioning of them, all the little details, right down to the spatter. And we're doing a limited edition of 25 sets of special tattoo techniques from Brigham. I think the first two just went up for sale. Something to check out if you guys like that kind of stuff, and I do. I'm a big geek. I love it. After the success of the Batman, brought my age of years of the older audience back to Turtle Crossover. We're now doing Turtles animated, Turtles and Animated Batman Crossover, which is coming up soon. And that's a sneak peek at the cover. And Melody finally brought Batman again to run the animated Turtles. And I literally just finished this cover. It's our Christmas cover, so you guys are the first one to see it. I finished it before I flew here. So that's a sneak peek of my ode to the Christmas Story, which is the greatest Christmas movie ever. It's going to be a fun issue as well. And there's me working in the studio. That's what I'm not here hanging out with you guys. I'm home drawing turtles, writing turtle stories, and working on some of my other projects that I always like to say, and I have the greatest job on the planet. Thanks to you guys. So your support is awesome. Thank you for our comments. And me, Jack Curry. Cool. So that's it for just I wanted to run through a little bit of history, sort of what's going on. But if you guys have any questions, I think we've got a little bit of time before we all run back down to the show. Buy more cool stuff. Yes, sir. Right back.
Yeah. So I noticed with the second movie, I mean, it was awesome, very kid friendly. Like my nephews loved it. I was wondering if there's any plans to like kind of take the movies and make them more like adult, like Dark Knight level seriousness. Is that in the works?
You know, I would love that. Especially, I've been really enjoying what Warner Brothers has been doing with the, you know, the age-year-older animated stuff. Especially like when they animated, you know, Frank Miller's. You know, Dark Knight, original Dark Knight graphic novel, and keeping all the edge in there, and then the Killing Joke, which is, I don't know if that's out yet, it's coming out soon.
It's out.
But I think that it might be, you know, the studio's Viacom, you know, Viacom owns the Turtles right now, so I don't think we'll ever see them maybe take that giant little leap. But I'd love to see, and actually, I'd love the opportunity to direct it as well. I'd love to see it next year. Much edgier, you know, homage to what the Turtles universe could be. And it could be, that way we can sort of guide it to a very specific audience without, misleading a younger audience, so to speak. So I hope so. Actually, one of my favorites, you guys see a movie called Turtles Forever? That was a really fun version of it. It was neat that they took the, you know, the edgier sort of 2000 Turtles, Fox Kids Turtles, and met the original 80s Turtles, and then they went back and met the Black and White Turtles, which was pretty awesome. Yes, sir.
I was intrigued by your opening shot of the house where you first moved into. Mm-hmm. Do you ever think of going back, because you had a 1975 Pinto flame mobile?
That's awesome.
Make the Ninja Turtles and give them a flame mobile.
Okay, I remember when we first had the studio, we were so broke we barely pay attention. But it was like he used to have a Vega, like a 73 Vega, and I was used to drive around. And I think like literally when you go up a hill, I'd have to get out and push just to help get it up the hill. But yeah, the Turtles could have a, I think the first cars I had was a Pinto, one of the ones that exploded and he was hit in the back. So. Luckily, I'm still here. But now, since we actually, I did a, I don't know if you saw the Turtles documentary, Turtle Power, but that was a fantastic, this East French documentary artist, director's team worked for 5 years and did this documentary. And we actually went back to the location, which they had unfortunately flattened the house. It's not just a vacant lot, but we went there. And sort of a wrap up, we do on the whole documentary, revisiting the space 30 years later is at the end of that. It's kind of cool. Both Pete and I got to hang out there. Point to lumps of grass where that used to be the kitchen and that used to be the studio. Yes, sir.
Could you talk a little about the animated film that came out in 07?
Oh, I love that film.
Yeah,
no, that was really good. What was the director's name? It just flew right out of my head. Shucks. It was awesome. He was working for Lucas now. But then, yeah, the 2007 film was really interesting because it was they had never done a fully animated film, and it was something we wanted to do for a while. And when we started development, it was with an Asian company called Imagi, and we sold the rights to distributed to Warner Brothers, and they gave us a very small budget, and we started working on a story. What was so great about that was like the licensing company, Warner Brothers, was that they didn't really think it would do any business or do anything, so the director and myself and some of the other producers, we really had to write and craft the story that we wanted to. So the first, you know, takes that kind of computer-generated film is like 24 months plus of production time. So like the first 18, 24 months, nobody bothered us, and so we just kind of did what we did, and then finally sort of started tuning into what we were doing, and they were like, hey, this is actually pretty good. So then they had to come in and see how much they could screw it up. So they changed a lot of things at the end, and there was a lot of really bizarre things you had to go through in Hollywood to do that stuff. But I really enjoyed that film. It was very clever, and I like the stylization, and you know, the fun fact that Donatello was like a tech consultant, and Michelangelo did the kids' birthday parties as Carl, that way. And the fight with Leonardo and Raphael on the rooftop in the rain was just like, wow, it was fantastic. So I enjoyed that movie.
What was the influence behind Casey Jones' name? Did it have anything to do with the Grateful Dead song?
A bit. It was more like, you know, I remember when I was a kid reading Casey at Bat. It was one of those, you know, children's stories or things that you read. It was, so Casey Jones seemed to be a great baseball character name. And when I originally thought of the original drawings, I did a Casey as a character. I came up with, like, you know, the sweats and, you know, everything was all fine with sweats and sneakers and, ripped t-shirt and had two baseball bats and a hockey mask, and I showed it to Pete, and I said, this is where I'm heading with the character, what do you think? And he said, you know what he needs is a golf bag. He needs a golf bag with a bunch of different weapons and a hockey stick and all that stuff, and that's how we worked. So many, you know, it was just, you know, none of the characters were really what they are without, you know, us sort of mind melding on these things, but it was just a, you know, happy accident. Like I said, it's like, you didn't know in that Raphael series, with Casey, I said, I wanted to try to come up with a character that was more crazy. It was crazier than Raphael, but I didn't want it like to be like a, you know, a lot of vigilantes. The superheroes had this very horrific backstory of their, you know, planet was blown up or their family was brutalized or murdered. And I just wanted a guy that decided to become a vigilante because he watched too much bad TV. And so when you first see Casey in that series, he's got three TVs playing and stuff like that. But it's fun. That was, you know, in those days we were so lucky that we had no editors. I mean, Pete and I were the secretaries. We answered the phone. We did the writing. We did the drawing. We did everything. We packed the boxes and shipped them out. We did the mail order. So we had no losses. So whatever we wanted to do with the story and where we wanted to take it was however silly or serious we wanted to be. So it was pretty awesome. Yes, in the back.
Ninja Turtles, or is there just a series you like in general?
I'm sorry, partially, yeah, too much heavy metal music when I was a kid.
Oh, is there any series you like?
What show? Any series outside of the Turtles?
Yeah, like
oh man, the list is like 6 miles long. No, I love it. No, actually, my wife and I, because we work, we both work at home. I have a home studio, and even in my home, I have the studios right out in the living room, right in the middle of everything, so I don't like to miss anything. We have a 10-year-old son, we have three wiener dogs, two bad kitties, and so we work at home. And so a lot of times, like at night, we in the studio would like binge watch something, and we've gone through like the 100 we particularly liked, Jessica Jones, we like, we've been watching Shameless, which was insane. It's like, that's what they do in that show. The 100, Daredevil, of course, was just fantastic. Man, there's a Game of Thrones, Fear of the Walking Dead, It's like actually, my wife has resisted the Walking Dead for many, many years, and I kept saying, you have to watch it. So finally, just started on season, episode one, season one, and you know, it was a binge of about 2 weeks. She watched all the way up through season four, and I was like, you know, she's more ravenous a fan than I am. So, but how about you? What do you watch? What's your favorite?
Nickelodeon has a show called Miraculous.
Oh, cool.
It's sort of a vigilante kind of, but Daredevil's also great.
Yeah, Daredevil's crazy. Wow. Awesome. Yes, sir.
So first of all, thank you for creating this. I'm an original 80s fan. I used to spend all my allowance to buy the action figures with my brothers and stuff. I was just curious. So it's been in, it's been a live action, it's been an animation, and it's been a comic. For each of the different ones, what do you think is the best thing? So what's the best thing about it when it's a comic that you can't do in a cartoon and vice versa?
Well, you know what's amazing to me is that it's that those lines have blurred so much now, because you look at like, you know, I remember like, you know, when I was growing up reading Daredevil or reading, Avengers or X-Men, and it's like now, today, with the technology, it's like, you know what Joss Whedon did with those Avengers movies. I love, you know, again, I love all the Marvel movies, you know, Deadpool, like, what? You know, it's crazy awesome. But it's like, it used to be like, you know, comic books, these fantastical tales, you could only tell if you could draw them. Or animate them, usually draw them, even animating them was far too difficult back, especially in the early Turtles cartoon shows. Each one of those cells was like 120,000 individual drawings to make up one 22-minute show. So the drawing had to be minimalized. But whatever you can imagine in drawing a comic book, you know, you could do it. And now, these days, it's like, depending on the budget with the movies, you can kind of go anywhere. So it's pretty fantastic. But I still like, to me, it's, like, you showed some of the clips of the movie, and I remember the first time I went down there, because, you know, up until that point, you know, even when we started working on the animated series, and you know, the entire staff to do a comic book was me and Pete. That was it. I remember, you know, the first time I went down to the set in Wilmington, North Carolina, where they shot the first two movies, I remember walking into the back lot, and, you know, if you see the back lot, it looks like a construction site ready to fall down, and it's, you know, all this staging and stuff. And it was a nice shoot. We kind of came around this corner, and there's New York City, you know, they went down the streets, and it's all lit up, and it was just like, you felt like you're right in the middle of New York City. And there's director Steve Barron standing in the middle of, like, you know, probably 75 people, all, you know, like that, do that, do this, and, you know, the amount of moving parts to pull off one scene that might only be 30 seconds long or less in a movie is just so epic. I was like, I was amazed that any movie comes out good ever. It's such an epic thing, and I was so grateful. It's like, you know, when I want to do a scene like that, it's just me sitting alone and drawing it. So, I'm a huge genre fan of just about everything. I like all kinds of movies, and I'm fascinated with the process.
I do feel in the printed word, you can see their internal thoughts less awkwardly than you can in a movie.
Yeah, you know, it's, you're right. It's a different kind of storytelling, and it's fun because it's like, you know, one of the things I love so much about Tom Wallace's scripts, the stuff he does in the new IDW series, is he doesn't overwrite it, he doesn't underwrite it. It's just enough so, you know, he really lets the visuals carry half the work and the dialogue to support it, because, you know, seeing comic books, you can see epic amounts of text, and it's like, I don't want to work that hard. But you just want to have a nice story, so yeah, it's a different thing. Okay, anybody else? Yes, Emily?
The current series is really close to the 100th episode, which is an achievement. Do you know anything that you're legally allowed to say about it, or is it a little bit under wraps, or?
There's a sniper over there that's taking me out if I go too far. Shucks. Oh man, I wish I could, because I like, that's the worst part, is like, sometimes we come to these shows and I've done this, like, because we work, you know, four or five issues ahead, so we just finished issue 65, and issue 61 just came out, so I was like, so I have to be careful, because IDW is really mad at me. So, but I want to tell you everything. Well, coffee over there, I'll feel good. No, I appreciate it. Keep watching. This is really, some really fantastic stuff we're doing, so appreciate it. So. Maybe there's one more over here. Yes, hey.
Hi. Back to Casey Jones. This has always been on my mind, but who's the one that came up with his battle cry, Goongala?
Oh, yeah.
It's from a Tarzan movie. I think it was like Goongala. It was like, you know, like a, it's like a, so I think we probably together, or I think I came up with like Cowabunga, because it was like, I used to, when I was growing up in a small town in Maine, I remember watching those Frankie Avalon, that sort of Shallow Beach blanket movies, you know, be like, you know, all these surfer dudes like Hang Ten, Cowabunga, and that was where that came from. But I remember Tarzan, he did Casey Jones, and he said, this Tarzan would be directing me, like, you know, making the lion stop eating that person, and he'd be like, Ugada, Ugada, or like, like maybe elephants run all over the world. Who the hell? No, I'm just kidding. Like, so that was kind of his joke. Yeah, that's like, you know, when you think about it, I used to assign in Kansas City. One of the cool things is I did this show with these like 50 kids, you know, from the age of like 4.5 to like 9. How to draw turtles, or talk about reading, where all these ideas come from. And that's, to me, is like, you know, I get so much reading comic books. I love the, you know, read children books growing up, I read comic books. And I remember my father was like, at some point, he's like, okay, you read a lot of comic books, but I want you to try to actually read a real book sometime, like you're supposed to in school and stuff, instead of drawing. And I'm like, what would be interesting? So one of the first books he gave me was a comic book called Wash It Down, which I don't know if you read it, it's an awesome, actually an awesome book. And that just blew my mind, and actually, I fell in love with reading. The next book, he said, you should read this other book. It's, he really liked it when he was a kid, it was called The Hobbit. And I remember reading that, like, you know, 1,000 times, and then Lord of the Rings and all that stuff. But I always said that, like, you know, when I was talking to these kids, and, you know, visiting inspiring writers and artists out there, and it's amazing, you know, where your imagination can take you, and, you know, expose yourself to anything and everything. Read, and if you're an artist, go be a shy, a copy. I mean, all my early drawings were tracings of Jack Kirby drawings until I figured out how to draw on my own. Draw everything, and the ideas come from the craziest places. Like, one of my favorite stories, people ask, like, where did you come up with the shredder? And the shredder was actually where we lived in the house in Dover, New Hampshire. Pete's wife was an amazing cook, so she would cook dinner, and then Pete and I would do the dishes. And typically get washed. I think he did a good job of washing and I would dry. And so one day I was drying up one of those rectangular metal cheese graters, you know, with a little handle on top, and I was sort of drying inside it, and I kind of slid it over my hand, and I was like, holy smokes, could you imagine if it was a bad guy that had one of these cheese graters on his arm? He would shred your skin right off. How horrific would that be? We should do a bad guy and call him the grater or something. He said, how about the shredder? Well, yeah, and so the shredder came out of doing dishes, so. You too, if you do dishes, you can. So. Good ideas are bad ideas come from everywhere. So. Yes, sir.
Any thoughts or plans on a Daredevil and Ninja Turtles team up, considering they kind of have similar origins?
Yes, they do. I would love that. And I think Marvel, I would love to do that. And I'm actually surprised that at some point that. Actually, I met Stan Lee once a long time. I met him a few times, and I remember you were talking about that origin story. And he said, yeah, I was going to sue you for that. but I didn't. He said that you guys were, you know, it was one of those things that we didn't want to seem like the bad guys. But I don't know if you guys know that the origin of. Young Matt Murdock jumps out to save a blind man crossing the street in front of his truck carrying radioactive waste through New York City. When that truck slams on its brake, this canister jars loose from the truck, hits young Matt Murdock in the eyes, which blinds him and then helps sort of increase all of his other senses, where he becomes Daredevil. And when we were coming to the origin of Turtles, I was a huge Daredevil fan. I read it since I was very young. It was Batman and Daredevil were some of my favorite characters. To me, they never said what happened to that canister after hitting that murder in the eyes. So the turtle origin, we have the canister continue bouncing down the street. And this poor boy named Chet later was standing precariously close to a sewer opening, holding a glass terrarium with four turtles in it. So the canister strikes the terrarium and goes down into the sewer. The ooze and the canister is cracked open next to this rat who's hanging out down there. That's how they're born. But we went further, even in that, in Frank Miller's awesome run on Daredevil. Again, I said I was a huge Daredevil fan. I remember Daredevil 158 when they introduced this new penciler named Frank Miller, and I was like, hey, this guy's pretty good. And then he blew us away for the next 30 issues, and Frank Miller created this evil clan of ninjas called the Ham. We have a foot. And Daredevil's mentor, and even in the TV series now, is Stick. We have Splinter. So, yeah, so it was a bit of a fun set. But no, I don't think, I would love it. That would be, I've done, I mean, countless drawings of Turtles and Daredevil together. I've got a couple of notes on Daredevil Turtle crossover, but I don't know what happened. I was just really bad. Turtles in Manhattan. I love to do a Turtles in Manhattan crossover. Yes, sir.
I know it's getting close to like the 40th anniversary of the Turtles. You're gonna do anything special for like maybe the 40th, but more or less like the 50th? Like maybe more than just like a couple series of comics, maybe just like one big like short story? I think that'd be kind of cool.
Thank you. One of the cool things we've started doing Friday Night is that besides the ongoing series, there are two graphic novels for them. And, you know, every once in a while I say, depending on how what's going on in the storyline or what I'm doing, that they'll let me, you know, just go off and do something sort of out of continuity or out of context and do something lengthy. And I'd love to do something. Actually, you know, in a perfect world, it would be great to team up with Peter Laird and come up with a story. You invite me to find a drawing or work with another artist to get you the breakdowns, but that's a great idea. I definitely think I'd like to work with Peter, and he's the man. So, I think are we doing on time? One more question? Actually, we're gonna do, let's do one more question, and then we're going to let you guys go back and enjoy the show. We've got a photo ops, and then we're back time from 3:30 to whatever, 3:30 to 5:30. So if you didn't get a chance to say hi this morning, get something signed. We're doing a couple things and we'll be back at the table for the afternoon. So let's do one more. We'll do two quick questions. So, yes, sir. You start there and we'll do Paul Simpson.
Quick question. For all the other canons that have been created for the Turtles since you created the original comics, are there any new characters or original characters that you didn't create that are you like that you like or are your favorites? Or?
From like the release issues?
And... Yeah, from the movies, the animated series, like there were new original characters that were created in those outside of the original comics.
Man, you know, there's something, you know, I've got stacks of like doodles and sketchbooks, and like I'm like, my collection of stuff is like bordering on a border. Not even like toys and comics and stuff I collect, but even my old sketchbooks and stuff that I keep, and there's lots of doodles and lots of characters that I think have come all the way through. And what's been so cool about now, like the Nickelodeon series that we're doing, that Serum does, and what IDW does, is that not only do we, you know, each one has created its own kind of little separate universe. Connected universe, but this platform where you can pull in characters from multiple Turtle universes, like in the IDW series, for example, we brought, you know, the hot-rodding teenagers from Dimension X, from the early Turtles cartoon, back as, you know, freedom fighters, and they were fighting this big crime off World War. So you bring in old characters, turn them on the ear, turn them a little bit to the left or the right, and then add new characters like Old Hog in the series, and the same with the Nickelodeon series. So I think that, you know, again, it's hard. It's like some of the stuff I want to tell you about that we've already got coming. And then the same with, like, I just finished writing an episode of Turtles Season 5. So we're already working. Season 4 is being finished now with the animated episode. And we're already well into Season 5, so I wish I could